15, and the first session was about the vine dresser, or the husbandman, or the gardener, depending on which Bible version you're using. My mother tongue is French, so there are some words of the Bible, especially in the King James, sometimes that I do not know. So when I read about the husbandman, I was wondering, what is a husbandman? A husband and a man. So what does it have to do with the vine? But thank God we have dictionaries, and I found out that the husbandman is actually the correct word, the closest word to the original intent of the scriptures. Husbandman is a medieval word coming from England, even before the King James was written. And it means someone who takes care of the land for someone else. It's like a land worker, but that does it for someone else. And it's actually quite accurate. So sometimes this morning, you may hear me use either one of these words. But I started to talk about the vine dresser, or the husbandman, and the vine, in order to prepare us for the foundation that in the same way that the relationship of the worker of the land and the vine will be the same way that our relationship will be based upon the same thing as the vine dresser refer or relate to the vine. We will relate to the vine in the same way. So that's why I've done that. And remember the context of the text. The context is just the night. The last night Jesus had this meal, last meal with his disciples. It's a very special moment. You know, for you and me, when we visit our loved one, when I go to Canada and this is the last night I spend with my children, there's always like this is special emotions. We sometimes tears and hugging and special words of appreciation and love and things. So Jesus was with his disciples, giving them his last message. It's important. That night is really, really important. And the message we're going to look at is a metaphor. It's or a parable, some people call it. It's not a text to really draw a theology, but it's something to apply, to look at, to refer to our spiritual life this morning. So that's what I want to do. And I want to also call upon you this morning, and I hope that I will address you as Jesus addressed his disciples, as disciples. So I'm talking to you as mature believer and learning from this picture of the vineyard lessons for your spiritual life. Are you okay? All right. So Jesus says, you are the vine, I am the branches. I am the vine, you are the branches. Okay. You see, you did not even notice my mistake. Yeah. All right. So let's look at the next slide. Isn't it beautiful? Yes, but this is not really what we are going to talk about. What we are going to talk about is the reality of the next picture. This is it. This is you right there. You see that? You recognize yourself there. This is you, not the beautiful one. The beautiful one is what God's going to do with you. But this is probably where we are right now in our life. And we will talk about that. When you look at a vineyard, sometimes when I go, like, if you have ever been into the region of Niagara Falls in Canada, you will see a lot of vineyards like this. And if you are not in the harvest season, it's not really nice. It's just like dark gray wood, looks almost like lifeless and not appealing at all. So except it would blossom and have fruit, it almost looked like it has no value. Let's look at the next slide. We'll start reading our text today, and you can read it out loud with me. Every branch and me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into fire and burned. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. So in this text, chapter 15, we have some key words. And some of the key words is the vine, the branch, It's you. Can you say this morning with me? I am the branch.
I am the branch.
Yes, good, good. So you are the branch and fruits. So these are the key words that we want to look at this morning. What does the branch teach us of our life in Christ? What is just like a branch like? What does it do? What can we learn about? The first lesson we can learn is that the branch exists for a single purpose. And this will be true also of your spiritual life. One purpose, to bear fruit. That's the sole reason of our existence. So the first lesson is a lesson of dedication. Have you, this morning, being the branch, you said, I am the branch. Have you said that? You said, I am the branch. So as being the branch and accepting that role and the life that comes from the vine, have you made a conscious decision, a dedication of your life to be the branch, a life and fruit bearing branch? If not, that's a lesson for you. That's the sole purpose of your existence and mine. You know, as human beings living busy in our society, we set ourselves a lot of goals. And this is natural. We live in this world. We have children. We go to work. We do all sorts of things. We buy, we sell. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But God wants to elevate us. That is something that is it should be intertwined with all of the other aspects of our life. A higher goal. We talked about the tableland, the higher ground this morning. And it is to realize that my life, my purpose, why I'm here, why Jesus saved me, that he loves me so much, it's to become a fruit-bearing branch, and that I will be glorifying his name. Amen? So first lesson is dedication. Have you dedicated your life to that? The second lesson is that the branch is the exact same likeness to the branch to the vine. So the vine is the same wood. It's on the same ground. It's on the same place. It carries the same life and the same purpose. The same. Second lesson is conformity. Conformity to the goal, to the character, to the intention of Jesus Christ, who is divine, and we are his branch connected to him in character and in work. The third lesson is one also very important, because the branch has nothing. Take the branch, put it here. What do you find? You find this here. There's nothing. There's no life. A branch, that's why the comparison is given here. If you look at verse 6, if anyone does not abide in the branch, he will wither. It will be thrown away. And I was listening to some sermons when I was preparing. A lot of pastors and Bible teachers really develop who is the branch that withers, that is cut off. But I believe that as a metaphor and a parable, this is not the purpose of this teaching. The purpose is not about who are the vines. Am I right? Am I saved? Not saved? Am I losing my salvation or not? There's nothing to do with that. The purpose is to contrast the fact that you, who are supposed to abide in me, what happens if you don't abide? It's not about who is the cut-off branch. It's about, are you bearing fruit or are you not bearing fruits? So I think this is more the correct look at that. So we find that the vine is the one that has the life, the sap, the strength, and carries it and support the life into the branch. So I am the branch. Can you say that again?
I am the branch.
Can you say, I have nothing? When it comes to fruit-bearing and spiritual achievement, I have nothing. It will all be because I abide, because of the life, the sap, and the strength that comes. And that is such a connection with praying, with fasting at the beginning of the year. That's why I think this text is just perfect for us and looking at fasting, praying as a church, and move on about my life. So that's why we want to. So the third lesson is one of dependence. Let's look at fruit now, the second key word, fruit. What the Lord has to say to us about fruit? Simply this. The fruit is the glory of the branch. And it is also to bring glory to the Father. This is how, when we have much fruit, that the Father is glorified. So if you remove the fruit, there is no glory, there is no value in being the branch. It's useless, and the Father will chop over it. And that's what we saw in the picture just before that. However, we don't want to be chop, are we? We want to bear a lot of fruit. Amen. So if it is useless, it's going to be chopped. If it is fruitful, it's going to be helped to be more fruitful. And I think, unfortunately, many Christians, especially in our wealthy Western society based on self-satisfactions, indulgence, and pleasure-seeking, we forgot a lot of the importance of that lesson of fruit-bearing that is the sole goal of our existence, the one thing that we have been saved for. Amen? And that's a great mistake. God made you a branch so that Christ may, through you, save. Share His word. It goes to the Great Commission. It goes to the intention of God. The purpose why Jesus died on the cross and we are associated with His work, with His intention, with His interest. Your salvation, your business, your occupations, your relationship should be intertwined with the thought shared by Jesus here of fruit bearing. You can bear fruit in your office, you can bear fruit in your school, you can bear fruit at home with your children, you can bear fruit in any situation. And that's what God wants us to know. The second word, second expression is more fruit. Yay! Not only fruit, but more fruit. Maybe you look at yourself this morning, and I look at yourself, and I see fruits. And I believe there is a lot of fruits in this room here this morning. You have followed Jesus for a while. You have fruits. You are a fruit-bearing. But God wants to do more, wants more fruit. And more, you have fruit in your life. He wants more fruit of your life. Pastor Fayez, you have fruit in your life. Sure. He wants more fruit. And of every one of us, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away. Every branch that does bear fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. So you have the dominant theme. No fruit, fruit, more fruit. That's the progression that your life should be. If it's not like that, then we missed the lesson, the most important lesson of this text. Notice in this text that immediately after He said that if a branch bears no fruit, it is taken away, immediately in the same flow of thought, He will tell us that where there is fruit, the one desire of the vine dresser or the husbandman is to produce more fruit. As soon as he sees fruit in your life, his desire says, yay, I got one who carries fruit, the seed of fruit, the potential of fruit. I can build something in him and her. I can do something, there will be more fruit. That's his purpose. Isn't it interesting to think? Like many times, you and I, we think differently. Oh, I have more fruit. Okay, I can take a break. Okay? We stop. We sit and we relax. The Father says, oh, I see some fruit. I'll get some more fruit. It's another way to look at that. I was talking to a friend this week to join our medical mission. And then he gave me some excuses why he might not join. And this is cool. He can choose not to go or to go. But the point that I want to bring is that his argument was based that he has already done 10 missions. So having done 10 missions is a good thing. He's got a lot of fruit when it comes to mission work. So it's enough. So if he doesn't go to this one, that's fine. So I'm thinking when I look at that, no fruit, fruit, more fruit. If we want to excuse ourselves when you see a limited amount of fruit, it's all right. It's our choice. We can do because, you know, God gave us free will. But if we want to enter into the fullness of God and realize that God wants more fruit, more fruit. Can you see more fruit this morning? That's my goal, more fruit. Okay. It's like many older Christians, it seems, you know, when you look at a young Christian, usually you see zeal, excitement. I remember my younger years. I was so crazy about what I was reading, about praying, about going to church. Like it, everything was wow, you know. And then when I was looking at older Christians at that time, I was saying, wow, they don't look so enthusiastic as we young Christians are. And I keep seeing the same pattern. So it's like we fall into a pattern of thinking, I've done enough already. I will let others, you know. Others can do it. I don't need to. And what I'm saying is not only about doing things, because maybe you think, oh, he wants us to do certain things, go to mission. Yes, I want. Yes. I declare it. Yes, I want. Yes, I wish that you will all go and join all the mission work that we are doing in every ways. But it's not only about doing. It's about character also, because we are attached to the vine. And there is a life of the vine that is come, a likeness to the character and the beauty and the work of Jesus Christ. So give me an example. If I see in my life character flaws, and in my maturity of age, I says, well, that's the way I am. So you have to accept me with my flaws. This is how I am. Then that means no fruit. Little fruit, but no more fruit. As soon as I, you know, accept me with my flaws, then it's like no more fruit. You stop that one already. So that's why I'm saying in this example that it is not only about doing things, going on mission or saving people. It's about who you are. It's about the beauty of Christ and our character as well. If we accept our flaws as this is the natural me, this is how I am, accept me like this, then it's not what Christ has intended. You have this mentality in the church of Laodicea. I am rich, I made it, I'm comfortable, I don't need anything anymore. So this is the Laodicean mentality, and we certainly don't want to be like that. Amen? Hallelujah. Okay. Like in the same service, there's always a little bit more sound coming from that side than from that side. But you are more numerous on that side. So that should be more noise on your side. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah. More fruit. Yes. Maybe it's because Brother Stephen heard the sermon, so he knows that he has to do. Yeah. Yeah. Our highest desire should be, listen carefully, there's a little trick into this one, to know whether or not we are bearing all the fruits that the vine is giving me life for. Okay, I'm bearing fruit, but the question is, am I bearing all the fruits or just the fruit? And this is something we need to examine. Are we bearing all the fruits intended for us? When you see the expression more fruit, it also carries divine authority. I want more fruit. It comes from the vine dresser. It comes from God, the owners of the vine. He wants more fruit. He expects more fruit. He's going to work for more fruit. So there's a divine authority in this talk. And the true disciple, because it says in the later on in the text we looked at, the true disciple, this is the mark of the true disciple. So I'm talking to true disciple here this morning. The true disciples search his life and her life. And that's why prayer, fasting, time to stop, be still, and know that I am God. Every time we will spend time like this, the true disciple will search his life whether there is more fruit, for more fruit. And he will turn his gaze to the Lord and ask the Lord, Lord, point to me. The endurance, bring to me what is keeping me, the wild shoots, that the useless branch, because I really want to bear some more fruit, because I know it's your desire. So I agree with that. But Lord, you need to help me, because if there's something in my life that keeps me from more fruit, please show it to me. If you think this is true, what I just said, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't remember what I just said, just say, what? Okay, no, it was okay, fine. Okay. The expression more fruit is also one of the most encouraging expression given to the branch that is already bearing fruit. Can you imagine? You are bearing fruit and you're happy. Your life, you are a happy Christian, you go to church, you have a good church, you're zealous, you're moving ahead with your life, you read your Bible, you do everything. And then comes this most encouraging sentence to you who is already a happy Christian: more fruit. So it's not a punishment. It's an encouragement. It's a motivation. You can bear more fruit. I see that you can get more fruit in your life. I can be honored with your life even more. So that is an encouragement. Hey, hallelujah. I'm so excited about that. I hope you are too. The owner of a vine will do everything to make the vintage as rich and abundant as possible. Is that true, this? He will do everything to make it as beautiful as this and get all this abundant grape. So the divine husbandman, your divine husbandman, will do all that is needed to make us bear more fruit. Are you ready? Now we're ready to bear fruit? Okay, let's go to the next slide. Oh, it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt. We're talking about the pruning. Didn't we read that the branch that bears fruit is going to prune to bring more fruit? So this is what your life is. This is the process of the work of God in your life. Amen? Amen. I know that you are not too excited about that, because it seems that it is quite cutting and right, it doesn't look so. I prefer to see myself as the nice pictures of the hilly vine, rich and grape, than to see that. But you will realize that every year you're going back to be just like that here, the stock. Every year the gardener will bring you to that stage here, and then he will have to work a lot, and we will talk about all of these steps so that there will be more fruit. This is the vine that is prepared for the production of fruit. This is the development and the growth. So don't fall asleep, because if you fall asleep, you will not see the pictures. And the pictures is part of, you know, connecting with you to help you understand the spiritual lesson of the things. And you can say ouch if you want to, okay? So if you look at the work of the Father in the vine, toward the vine, you will notice that the main work, almost the only work, it's the pruning. That's the greatest, the only, the most important work is the pruning. So, whoa, that means I'm the branch. It's going to happen to me as well. Yes, it's going to happen to me as well. Let's fast and pray and learn more and make ourselves available to God. If it is left on itself, the vine is one of these plants that will run wild the quickest. It goes, all the shoots goes here and there. If you look at the next picture just for a moment, if you look here, very quickly, this is like going in every direction. Okay, let's come back to the previous one. So the vine will grow normally. A lot of branches will go to the ground. The wild beasts will destroy. The decay will come into. So one of the main work will be to start with what we call a trellis, which is like a wires that is used between poles. Series of wires stretching between poles, designed to keep the branches and the grapes well above the ground and attach as the vine dresser wants to bring them in whatever direction it is. So that's one of the first work. And that's it carries a very good lesson for us today. God does not let the branches of our life go into any sorts of directions, all directions, going wild. That's not how we will bear fruit. This is not how we will have more fruit. God has a strategy. God has the expertise. And God sees the potential, and he will give the direction that he wants us. So this trellis and these wires are the lines of God's will and God's plan for you, the direction that he has for you. Not my direction, like, oh, this way, I like this, I like that, I don't like this, I don't want that, too hard to pay, too much sacrifice, yeah, I prefer the easy way. No, God says, let me point you in the directions that I want you, because I know how to produce more fruit in you. He is the expert. Amen? If you believe that, yes, hallelujah. So it's a beautiful illustration of how we are to follow Jesus closely and the lines of God's intended plan. If it is good to bear fruit, it will be pruned. If you have fruit, you will be pruned. There is no other way around that. So know this. The branches sometimes, or the long shoots, 8-10 feet or more, will be cut down close to the stem, and nothing will be left except 1 or 2 inch. If you see a lot of these, very, very, very short, and it will be cut, and you will only have little stems that will be left. You see these stalk here. This is the what God will bring you like in order to produce more fruit into your life. And this is done every single year. After each session of work or productivity, it has to return to that stage. Remember, after you look at the abundance of fruit and branch that we have seen in the nice picture at the beginning, if it would remain like this, it would be horrible, because all the sap that should be focused to concentrate to fruitfulness will be just wasted, and all these useless branches going into all directions, and there would be no more fruitfulness very quickly. And not only that, but the harvest. Think about going there. When you look at some pictures of the going in between the rows to harvest, you see you have the grapes. They are right here in front of you, just in good height to be harvested. If you let it grow wild, you will not even be able to harvest whatever little fruit that there will be into that. So that's really important. Point number two, the best branches in the vine requires pruning. So are you a good Christian this morning? A disciple, the best branches require pruning. That's what God is telling us this morning. Otherwise, the sap will be wasted. One of the things that God is doing, let's go to slide number 6. God is looking at the vine. You see, he's working, and he's always. Actually, this picture, I like it here because it shows what happens to the dead branches, the branches that are, you know, not abiding. They have some sorts of a wheelbarrow, and they just carry it. And this is in France, some region of France, and they are just cutting, working with the trellis, and you know, putting the directions to the branches. But everything that is useless is going to be burnt right there. And it's not going to pollute the floor or to dirty. It's being burnt right there in the wheelbarrow and then discarded over there. But the vine dresser is wonderful. Actually, he's not expecting fine fruit immediately. He knows it will take a season of growth. It will take a season of maturity, obedience, testing, growth, the absorbing of the nutrients and things like that. But what he does, he's walking through the vineyard and he's looking for fruit bud. He's looking for signs of life, signs of fruitfulness. You see, this is like a big, this is only like a 2 inches long, so it's really, really little. So he walks in the vineyard, and when he sees little seeds that will produce little flower, he rejoices. I found potential. It's going to produce. And then he sees the already in advance, the harvest will be plentiful because there's a lot of these little ones. And then he continues looking. And then just around this, there are some little fresh little limbs that are not having little seeds of flowers. They are going to be taken away because they are not going to use the sap to prevent that one to produce the most fruit according to its potential. This is describing the work of God in your life right now. This is how we start 2017. The caretaker cuts whatever is dead. We go into fasting. We search the Lord. We say, yes, Lord, I acknowledge who you are to me and what is my role to you. Prunes me. Prune the good ones. Lord, there is fruit and I want more fruit. Clearing away the unproductive to produce more. maximizing the nutrients spent on the fruit. He watches for fruit buds. It is future oriented. Whatever the Lord is doing into your life is future oriented. If you look at yourself right now, maybe what you see is this. There's no fruit right now at that season of work of God. But the pruning is looking at the future. It's future oriented. There will be fruit. There will be fruit. 2017, can you see that this morning? There will be fruit in my life. Yes, there will be fruit in my life this week. So you cut now, produce gain later. That's what God. Pruning is for your spiritual welfare, and it reduces our dependence upon the flesh. Isn't it wonderful when you think about that? It looks hard. It looks painful. Yes, there will be pain and the making, but the result, what God sees, what God wants, what God desires of you and me as a branch is wonderful. I hope you agree with that. And that realizing my role and view of that, this is the wonderful picture that God has given to us today. That's why even the most sincere and zealous of the Lord's servant requires pruning and care similar to this in our spiritual life. Fasting and prayer yearly. This process is repeated always. This is a precious lesson for us. And this pruning has nothing to do about sin. We're not talking about sin. We're talking about disciples. We're talking about people who have fruits. We're talking about people who love God. Who are, you know, already in the vine, attached to the vine. We're not talking about sin. We're not pruning something that is without, like the weeds and the thorns. We're talking about pruning something from within, something from has to do with character, with our own choices and our own entrance and our own life that will prevent us from beginning being the one that will bear more fruit. Realize that it's not from outside. It's from inside. Each year, you and I, as Christians, every day, actually, not each year, all the time, we use our natural self. We use our brain, we use our money, we use our knowledge, we use our hands, our body, we talk about our religious life, our spiritual service. We use what we are to do that. At the end of a season, we may be very proud of our achievement. And then, if we are too proud of our own achievement and we acquire experience in the ministry or in our Christian life, it would be natural to depend upon my previous experience. If I start to think in this way, my fruitfulness will diminish. Because, remember, without me, you cannot do. So, if I'm not careful, I will be living my religious life based on my own expertise, my own success from the past, my flesh, and then there would not be so much fruit. So that's why pruning is so, so important. God knows the most favorable thing that He can do for us. Amen? He sees the sprouts of our ambitions and goals shooting in every direction. Do you have these this morning? Sprouts of your own quirks and whatever it is. So God will prune the buds of our selfish desire so that there will be no wasting of energy in the wrong places, so that we will be focused. So let's focus this year with our vine dresser this morning. Stop here for a moment and think about your life. Is there fruit? More fruit? Am I aware? Am I dedicated to that? Am I yielding? Am I being filled with the sap in the life of Jesus, the vine? Jesus Christ went to the cross. When He walked to the cross, He was being pruned. He was being pruned as a man. He went there as a man, for man. He was pruned. He was taken of His clothes. He was beaten and He was sent to the cross. So you and I, if we are going to make choices and choose the way of the cross, we have to be prone. Otherwise, we will choose the way of my flesh, the way that is pleasing to me, the easy way. That's not the natural me. So God is bringing us to rediscover over and over in times of rediscovering our dependence, our need. My grace is sufficient. That otherwise we will be like Paul, who talks to the church in Corinthians and says, what I see is not mature believers, I see babes. I see babes in the flesh, you're fighting, you're not growing anymore. I will talk to the Galatians and he will say, you started very well in the spirit and now you are going back to the flesh. That's why pruning. We need pruning to correct all of these wrong things in our own life. God used many techniques of pruning us to discipline, to correct, to restore our dedication. And the goal of the pruning is to stop the growth of the flesh, which is such the natural self. It's the biggest enemy of our own life, and to lead us into the spirit. Some pruning experience will come in the form of, I think one of the very, very used form of pruning that God used is that stalling our plans, or thwarting our plans, or preventing our plans. Because our plans are very important. And we tell God, this is why don't you do it right now, God? I need it right now, Lord. And this is my plan, O Lord. Bless me and my plan, O Lord, and all this. And God says, sometimes he will, of course, because it's his will. And we are ready. We have been attached in the line of his will. But sometimes he says, that's not where you will bear fruits. So he will thwart. He will prevent us from going fully into our plan. And that's one of the pruning that God sometimes will use. Sometimes it will be for certain, and we read about it continually, persecutions and oppositions. How many of our dear brother and sisters around the world are being pruned big time and prison? Sometimes losing material possessions. I know a couple in our home church in Canada, twice. They went in bankruptcy, and not because they are stupid. They were doing the right thing. They built a very good business. But when they sold it, something happened and they lost. The first time, they took it before the Lord. They continued in the Lord. And the second time, they had like some sorts of a 7-Eleven with a service station, and it was very prosperous. They sold it because it was very hard work. They wanted to have a life more cozy and easy. They lost everything. Second time, they started a home for older people, senior citizens. They built a big business. They sold it, and again, it went into almost nothing. And it's not because they made a business. It's just like one of these weird and strange situations that happens to people sometimes. But if you talk to them, you will find them that they love Jesus. And they are bearing fruits, and they discovered in their life something that is more important than the success of a business, but the union with Christ. So sometimes it can go in this way, a loss of reputation, a loss of friends. Sometimes we need to lose certain friends that we may be attached too much, and that's not the friends that we should be attaching ourselves to. So in Psalm 119, verse 67, just I will read to you two verses. You don't have to look at it. It's very short. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. The same Bible verse. I used to wander off until you disciplined me, but now I closely follow your word. So you see the pruning. Until you pruned me, I was my shootings in every direction. I was going astray. But now I'm following closely your work. So pruning is necessary for you. After the resurrection, when the disciples, you know, they were so discouraged. They lost the sense of their missions. Peter says, I'm going fishing. They all says, let's go fishing. Let's start our company back. Let's put it back in order. And all night, these expert fishermen caught nothing. They failed. It's their trade. They failed until the next morning when they met Jesus on the shore. No catching fish was a pruning experience for them. They failed. It was meant to lead them back into fishing for men. And how many of us, we need constantly to be pruned so that, you know, we go in our own business and our own things. And God says, this is not exactly what's the best for you. So pruning. Paul rebuked Peter. They were together in Galatian at church. And he rebuked him publicly. Peter, the great apostle, the follower of Jesus Christ. Peter rebuked him in front of the pagan, the Gentiles, and in front of the Jewish people. You're doing wrong. You're absolutely wrong. You have a character of flaws. You're not honoring God publicly. That's a tough pruning technique. How many of us would like that to take place in our church? You are wrong. You know, so that's what God is doing. But you know, in closing, true disciples of the Lord are not discouraged by the pruning of the Lord. They are not offended. They don't quit because they are going through a time of pruning, because they recognize the hand of the caring expert vine dresser. They recognize that he is correcting in them the direction for them, that it is the Lord's will and plan that is the best for them. They recognize it. So when pruning comes, instead of being angry with God, complaining, or being so discouraged or depressed that we will walk away, recognize God is wanting fruit and more fruit for all of us. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you stand? We're closing. I just want to tell you a story in closing. This is one of the, I would say, my hero, one of my heroes, the wife of one of my heroes, a very spiritual woman. She wrote a book, How I Know God Answers Prayer. And Bridget was reading it this week, and she referred to that passage and says, please, give me that so I can share in the sermon on Sunday. This is a woman that have given their life for Christ. They lost their children in China. The greatest revivalist in the whole history of China is a Canadian from London, Ontario, Jonathan Goforth and Rosalind, their wife. They have brought a revival in the northwest of China. They have been in Henan province. They have experienced everything. He's been caught by a machete. He has seen one of his child falling like dead under somebody else at the Boxer Rebellion. They have lost everything in the flood. And years later, they have lost everything in the fire. And he has finished his ministry in China blind, but he would continue to serve the Lord. So that's the wife. And she said this about herself, that she had conflict with her sinful self and character that passed over until about the fifth year of her missionary work in China. 5 years. She's like a missionary in China, and she sees all the character flaws in her life. I grieve to say that the new life in a foreign land, climate, people, irritating condition, culture, seem to have developed rather than subdued my natural disposition. So instead of having improved, it has made it worse. Her natural disposition was becoming worse. One day as I sat by a paper window at dusk, I heard a conversation of two Christian women talking about me. Yes, she is a hard-working woman, a zealous preacher, and she truly loves us. But oh, what a temper she has. If she would only live more as she preaches. Ouch. So anyway, bring that. This is one of the most spiritual women you can imagine. And this is her life described here by herself in humility and in truthfulness. How many mothers here have been screaming at your children, don't raise your hands this week? I've been impatient, you know? So I know you know what I'm referring to. Our natural self that needs so much the pruning techniques of the Lord. And he knows which techniques to use for which quirks and which flaws that we have, so that he will get more fruit. As we begin 2017, won't we yield to the Lord this morning. Would you close your eyes and end up offering your